In the early 1900s, one person inspired by Darwin's theories was Russian scientist Ilya Ivanovich Ivanov, one of the world's foremost experts in the artificial insemination of farm animals. His research was backed by Tsar Nicholas II, who granted funds for Ivanov to discover if such techniques could be used for the breeding of horses or even to create new species unknown to nature.
The Tsars liked artificial insemination because it enabled you to do rather crazy things. So Ivanov created the world's first zorse, zebra-horse hybrid.
With the funding of royal patrons, the future looked bright for Ivanov's hybrid dream.
But of course, come the communist revolution, all of that goes by the wayside.
In 1918, Bolshevik revolutionaries executed Tsar Nicholas II and his family. Ivanov's network of powerful sponsors was no more.
But Ivanov is an adaptive kind of guy, and he realizes that there's an element of artificial insemination that could appeal to the new regime.
In 1910, at a zoological conference in Austria, Ivanov had speculated that it might be possible to inseminate a female ape with human sperm. But under the Tsar, such experiments would have been blocked by the Orthodox Church. Now in 1924, at the age of 54, Ivanov reached out to Stalin's regime.
From the first stages of my scientific research, I tried to arrange experiments in crossing humans and apes. I assumed that the Soviet government could help me in the interests of science and propaganda.
The founding fathers of communism, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, had been heavily influenced by the works of Darwin. In fact, the leader of the new Soviet Union, Vladimir Lenin, kept a small statuette of an ape contemplating a human skull on his desk.
Darwinism was a kind of pretext for Marxism in so many ways.
On the 20th of September, 1924, Ivanov received a reply from the Soviet Department of Agriculture.
The topic proposed by Professor Ivanov should become a decisive blow to the religious teachings and may be aptly used in our propaganda and in our struggle for the liberation of working people from the power of the church.
Ivanov had won the backing of the Soviet government.
They approved the project submitted by Ilya Ivanov and gave quite significant sums of money in gold.
Ivanov can now make plans for an expedition to Africa. In November 1926, Ilya Ivanov and his 22-year-old son, Ilya Illich, arrived by ship to Conakry, the capital of French Guinea. Traveling into the interior, they capture three female chimpanzees. A few weeks later, 10 more chimpanzees are delivered to Conakry by local hunters, restrained with nets, ready for the forced introduction of human sperm by artificial insemination. The first two chimpanzees are brought to Ivanov. He recorded the procedure in his laboratory diary.
The sperm was obtained from a man whose age isn't exactly known, at least not older than 30, not completely clear whether he had children.
Concerned that local staff might protest if they realized what was being attempted, Ivanov performs the insemination, assisted only by his son.
The injection took place in a very nervous atmosphere and in uncomfortable conditions. The threat from the apes, the work on the open ground, and the necessity to conceal.
In the rush to perform the procedure, Ivanov was forced to abandon his normal, slow, careful approach. A few weeks after the insemination, the two chimpanzees were observed to be having periods. Things were not going as planned.
It very quickly becomes apparent that Ivanov can't really accomplish the task that he sets out to do. He's not able to produce the human-ape hybrid by inseminating female chimpanzees.
Driven by the need for secrecy, Ivanov had been in a hurry to complete the artificial insemination. What amounted to a brutal sexual assault likely caused considerable stress to the female chimpanzees.
What is important for chimpanzees as for other individuals to reproduce is to have enough food and to not have too much stress, because they are stressed socially, they won't reproduce.
Ivanov had been funded by the Soviet government to produce a human-ape hybrid. They expected results. Inseminating female chimpanzees clearly wasn't working. He would need to rethink his experiment.
If you were to attempt to hybridize humans and chimpanzees, you have two options, basically. You could either inseminate a female chimpanzee with human semen, or you could inseminate a human female with chimpanzee semen.
So he then turns around and thinks, okay, maybe we can do it the other way around. Maybe we can impregnate human females with sperm of chimps.
Ivanov outlined his new plans to the French colonial authorities.
I informed the governor about my proposed program of work and about my plans to invite a doctor from the local hospital to participate in that work.
Ivanov is imagining essentially doing this under the cover of darkness without actually telling the women that he'd be impregnating.
His hope is that he can perform the insemination on unsuspecting local African women under the guise of conducting a medical procedure. A century ago, ideas about what it means to be human and how various human populations might differ from each other were often highly racialized.
There was a debate about whether Africans were even human beings. When they wanted to find out about this process of how we got from being the chimpanzee to being the white man, what they want to do is show how that definitely had to start with the black people. So the black people may have come from the apes, and they may be actually able to still mate with them, which is kind of a confirmation of their physical inferiority as well as their intellectual inferiority.
Such racist beliefs that Africans were closer to apes were often supported by lurid myths.
The French have a collection of kind of horror stories about how, you know, local women might be raped by chimpanzees and then ostracized from their local community.
The women raped by ape males are regarded as defiled. Such women are treated as pariahs, as socially dead, and as I was told, they usually disappear without a trace.
The degree to which we should take these stories seriously, I think, is a complicated one. But, certainly might be something that is in the local folklore. But certainly the French think it is, and that's what matters in this particular moment.
The French governor worries that the local population may discover what Ivanov is up to.
The doctor stated that the governor objected to carrying out the experiments at the hospital. He has categorically banned doing the experiments in the hospital without his permission.
As long as he was inseminating the apes by human sperm, the French didn't see this a moral issue, because that was basically an experiment on animals. But they objected to the idea of inseminating humans by the sperm of the ape. That the French found to be unacceptable.
A bolt from the blue. Our work has been denied. It is a terrible blow.
The reason the French are so sensitive to this is you have to think about how French colonialism works at the time. So these people need the cooperation of local notables in order to make this thing hang together. So they are going to be extremely careful about upsetting local populations. If they want to build a railroad, then they'll push and bring in the military and just tell people what to do, no matter the human cost. But a Russian scientist with a sort of funky sounding idea about hybridizing apes and men, no, they're not going to do it. It's not worth the cost.
Ivanov now has no choice but to gather his apes and return to the Soviet Union, hoping to continue his work.